Hello and welcome to Vodcast 14.5A. This Vodcast is the first part of a two-part series regarding tornadoes. When I was a little kid, I was simultaneously fascinated by and terrified of tornadoes. In my lifetime, I've probably had hundreds of nightmares that included tornadoes. But for whatever reason, I've always found them interesting and I've always wanted to learn more about them. By definition, a tornado is a violent local windstorm of short duration. There are some very important features I'd like to overview regarding tornadoes in this vodcast. First and foremost, tornadoes feature a rotating column of air which we'll call a vortex that extends down from a cumulonimbus cloud. And that vortex really is the signature feature we all think of when we think of tornadoes. In previous vodcasts, I've discussed cyclones, but you can kind of think of a tornado as a cyclone on steroids, because on the inside of a tornado, the pressure can drop by as much as 10% in comparison to the surroundings. So what that basically means is there is extremely low pressure inside of a tornado. And because of that low pressure, surrounding air is going to violently rush towards the tornado. It's going to stream inward, it's going to spiral upward, and it's going to merge with the cumulonimbus cloud high above. But because of that incredibly low center that exists inside of tornadoes, wind speeds can approach 300 miles per hour. Another very important feature regarding tornadoes is their typical path. Generally speaking, tornadoes will move from southwest to northeast. I'd like to draw your attention to the map you see on the screen of Illinois. Shown on this map are literally hundreds of different tornado paths. And if you take some time to pause the video and look at all these paths, you'll notice that the overwhelming majority of them are in the northeast direction. If you take a look at the top left part of this image, you'll see that 50% of tornadoes will move in the northeast direction. Most tornadoes will occur slightly ahead of an advancing cold front. And with maritime tropical air masses, the winds tend to come from the southwest direction. The final thing I'd like to discuss regarding tornado features is the fact that some tornadoes can have multiple suction vortices. Now for starters, I should mention that some tornadoes will consist of just a single vortex. And it's worth stressing that a vortex is that column of air that extends down from a cumulonimbus cloud. But for some of the really large, wide tornadoes, there can be multiple suction vortices occurring within that tornado. I'd like to turn your attention to the image shown at the top right portion of this slide. In this image, we see what would be a very wide tornado. But on the inside of the tornado, we actually see three suction vortices, and they're moving in a counterclockwise path about the tornado center. That should be expected, because around cyclonic centers, we expect counterclockwise movement of air. What's really interesting about tornadoes that include multiple suction vortices is that if this tornado passes over your house, but somehow the three suction vortices manage to miss your house, you might see minimal property damage. But if one of those suction vortices were to hit your neighbor's house, it could completely destroy it. I'd like to conclude this video podcast by talking about tornado occurrence and tornado development. First and foremost, it's worth stating that tornadoes are associated with severe thunderstorms. Oftentimes, these will be the storms that produce high winds, heavy rainfall, and hail. Now, in part two of the tornado vodcast, I'm going to go into detail on the tornado formation mechanism, but for now, I'd just like to state that tornadoes are a product of interaction between thunderstorm updrafts and tropospheric winds. And hopefully in the next video podcast, that'll make more sense when I explain it thoroughly. Another very important point to note is that tornadoes will be most frequent from April to June. And the reason that they most commonly occur during those spring months is because there is a great contrast between the cold, dry continental polar air masses and the warm, humid maritime tropical air masses. Those continental polar air masses coming from the Canadian region will have extremely cold air, because during the spring months, the northern hemisphere hasn't really warmed yet. But those maritime tropical air masses, which often come off of the Gulf of Mexico, will contain very warm and very moist air. So when you get a clash between two air masses that are very different in terms of their temperatures, you have the ideal conditions for severe thunderstorms and tornado development. Regarding the general atmospheric conditions for tornadoes, they occur most often along a cold front, and that cold front is very often associated with a mid-latitude cyclone. Tornadoes are also associated with huge thunderstorms called supercells. And although scientists are still trying to fully understand the tornado formation mechanism, one very important tornado formation precondition is the presence of a mesocyclone. And on the screen, you see a picture of a tornado that developed the very day I filmed this video podcast. This is a tornado that occurred in Colorado. And the mesocyclone is the huge cylinder of rotating air you see above the tornado. In our next video podcast, I will go into much greater detail about the relationship between mesocyclones and tornado formation. Okay, that concludes part one of our tornado vodcast. Part two will focus on the tornado formation mechanism and tornado forecasting.